Workplace tenure, or how long someone stays in a workplace, is a big issue for leaders today, especially because the average tenure of an Australian worker currently sits at around 2 years and 9 months. If we extrapolate that over the lifetime of a school leaver today, noting that they will live longer and work later into their life, we predict that a school leaver could have 18 jobs across 6 careers in their lifetime. Now, we're just going to take a quick pause because I know what you're probably thinking. Has Ashley Fell suddenly developed a North American accent overnight? Unfortunately, not this time. My name is Holly, and I will actually be playing the role of host today as we're going to be diving in a little deeper into our fantastic future report host, Ashley Fell's journey at McCrindle, as she has just recently celebrated 10 years here. So hello, Ash. Welcome to your own podcast.
Thanks, Hol. I wish I developed a North American accent overnight. No, it was a delight to always hear a little bit of a different vibe and a different voice in people's ears. I feel like your accent's so much more sophisticated than mine is.
That is so, I would say the exact opposite. So thank you. You know what? I'll take it.
No, it's a really big privilege. It's not your first time on the podcast. We've actually had you on as a guest a couple of times, but also you've hosted another episode in my place. And if people don't know, your name is Holly Schaaf and your role at McCrindle is advisory executive. So you and I actually get the privilege of working quite closely together.
Yeah, that's wonderful.
You get to help our clients engage our McCrindle speakers and help them design solutions. And you're also the producer of the podcast.
Yes.
So you sit in on every episode. So you are, I'm putting it in good hands, the host role today.
I'm privileged and I'm honored. It is a delight to be able to sit in on each podcast and hear the wonderful insights and your hosting. And I'm sure the listeners are going to be delighted to hear from you again today, Ash. Second time, I think, in the guest seat. Is that right?
That's right. I mean, I love every topic and I get to craft the episodes and our questions and our guests. But I have had a couple of times where it's really been me who we couldn't outsource, you know, the guest part to. And one of those was the baby names that we did. I was very involved in that. And this one being, I guess, my reflections after 10 years, we thought, oh, it was interesting. Like, it felt weird to be like, we were having even a chat offline. Like, do you reckon this would be a good podcast episode?
Yeah,
it felt a bit self-indulgent to be like, these are my thoughts.
No.
But I know the listeners have known me for the 2 years that we've had this podcast going. And yeah, I put that post up on LinkedIn, which we're going to talk about today, about my reflections after 10 years. And it seemed to resonate with people,
for sure.
So we thought we'll put it in a podcast.
Yes, absolutely. And you know what, Ash, as you know, 10 years is no small thing. It is not a small endeavor to be somewhere for 10 years. So you certainly have a wealth of wisdom and insight and reflections. And that post that you did, just is genuinely has a lot of inspiration to it. And there was a lot of great engagement and feedback from that as well. So we did think, why not today delve a bit deeper into some of those insights, which we will get to as well. We'll do a bit of an intro background to you as well, Ash. But I guess just to give listeners today just a bit of a context around what we'll be chatting about, there are 10 reflections that Ashley had shared in her LinkedIn post celebrating her 10 years. And they are these, which we'll be highlighting a few of the key ones, and she'll be chatting more about them. But you can always head over to her LinkedIn to read the whole scope. So we have life is lived in the tension as number one. Number two, say yes to opportunities that scare you. Number three, great colleagues are invaluable. Number four, people underestimating you can be a blessing in disguise. Ooh. And number five, words of encouragement should not be undervalued. Number six, progress, not perfection. Number seven, regular rest is essential. Number eight, reading is a superpower. Number nine, learning takes place through osmosis. And number 10, don't forget to learn along the way. So I think it is quite clear, Ash, why we're going to be chatting about these today. That is such great advice you have there from 10 years, well lived, well worked here at McCrindle. But like I mentioned, before we get into some of those insights, let's just go back a little bit. You celebrated 10 years at McCrindle, and today you are known as an esteemed author and social researcher, but obviously it's been a journey to get to where you are today. So what has your career journey been like at McCrindle? Take us through that a little bit.
Yes. So I, as you mentioned, my role today is social researcher, director of advisory. Of course, that wasn't the role I stepped into 10 years ago. I definitely feel like I've gone through a few different iterations. I've literally been very much in your shoes in the role that you are in today. So really helping formulate our speaking team behind the scenes, helping do a lot of sales calls, kind of selling them in. And that kind of came about because when I started at McCrindle, I was hired into a research executive role and then very quickly kind of moved over to more of the communications, marketing, sales of our research. So back when I started, the team was about a quarter of the size it is today. So
ever-growing now.
Ever-growing. And because of that, I think I was actually afforded quite a lot of opportunities at a young age and early on in my career. So I had a lot of responsibility. I was basically like the marketing communications manager for the business. I didn't have that title, but I was I was doing it. I was managing projects for a bit. I was kind of doing sales calls. I was writing articles. I was posting them. I was creating EDMs in a much less sophisticated manner than we do today. Because 10 years ago, we had different technologies. We had different platforms for all of that. So yeah, started out in that role, moved into the sales and then into leadership as we grew and had a team kind of come under me, some really amazing people, yourself included, who I get the privilege of working alongside, but also being the leader that you, I guess, report to in a very kind of business language of that. So yeah, and then the speaking side, which is a huge part of my role, as you know, Hol, kind of came into my responsibility about, I think it was like 7 years ago. So yeah, at a pretty young age, I was given the opportunity to do that. And it's been something that I love to do and have kind of loved developing and been doing ever since then.
That's fantastic. And you won't say it yourself because you are incredibly humble, but you are fantastic at it. You are, definitely one of our most requested advisors going out there and constantly, you know, I'm the one who I'm privileged to be on these calls now with clients and getting to help them curate the solutions for their events and just get to hear, you know, I saw Ashley speak 5 years ago at this event, or, you know, she spoke at an event I went to last year and now I'd love to have her come speak to my marketing team or speak to our board and help us inform the strategy for the years ahead. And it's just really cool to always, you know, be the receiver of that really positive feedback. So you do an incredible job. And I think it goes to show your commitment and your diligence in leaning into that portion of your role over these last many, many years. It is not a small thing. And so, yeah, like you mentioned, that is such a big part of your role now, delivering insights through speaking at conferences, delivering presentations at events, conducting strategic workshops with boards, have your hand in all of those. And so I believe in your time at McCrindle, you've actually delivered about 250 presentations, which is wild. You get a gold star for that. But how did your professional speaking career come about then?
Yes, it's a great question. And it's one that I definitely reflected on because it is such a big part of my role and it's such a public facing part of my role. And part of that, even as host of the podcast, kind of ties in into that, going out and speaking and sharing the insights through this platform and this medium, but also on stages. And that professional speaker kind of title is a really unique one. It's a very niche industry. Not many people know what professional speakers do or how they get paid or how it works. And so I guess Mark had really pioneered that. Mark McCrindle, of course, our founder, he's been a professional speaker out being paid to speak at conferences to deliver engaging keynotes well before I ever came across McCrindle or knew of McCrindle in the media doing mini commentary. And about, as I mentioned, 3 or 4 years into my tenure, he kind of, I guess he saw something in me. I mean, I was quite involved in like debating in high school and public speaking a fair bit at school and in other stages in my life. So it hasn't ever really been something I've feared. I know a lot of people do fear public speaking, but I've had quite a lot of experience without really realizing I'd had it. And so he was like, oh, would you be interested in doing that? Because it's a service we offer. And me literally being a yes person for most of my 20s, I feel like in my 30s now, I'm a bit more like, got to learn to say no a bit better.
Yes. You go for the journey though. It's all part of the process. You got to go from one to the other, I think.
Totally. And I put that in my reflections. I feel like my first 10 years in the workforce particularly was very much like say yes, grab hold of everything. And that's afforded me amazing opportunities. And so with that, I was like, yeah, I'll give it a go. I'll see. Mm. And my first gig, I remember like paid professional speaking engagement was very stressful. I was very nervous. I think I cried like it was on the Monday morning and I was crying on the Friday because I was like, I can't do this. Who am I? This young 20 something year old woman going in, I can't do it. But again, the imposter syndrome was there and you just had to push through. And so then loved it. And Mark was like, how'd it go? And I was like, yeah, actually really enjoyed it. I've got heaps of work to do and heaps to learn, but I love it and have been doing it ever since. So hopefully it's a bit bit of gift, but also a lot of opportunity and just and learning and having that awkward, like, I got to listen to myself back. I got to watch this back and learn and take notes and to try and get better at it. So
that's fantastic. And even I think you highlighted it a bit there at the end. It's so interesting as well, because communication, like, you definitely have a natural communication skill and that can be a strength that people have, but being able to deliver that in a public speaking sort of setting, that definitely takes experience and skill, and you refine those more natural abilities there as well. And so over the last 7 years, like you mentioned, of you doing that, you have had a wealth of time to really get to lean into that that experience and that skill, and it's fantastic. It is funny what you mentioned as well there with professional speakers being a bit of a niche industry. Sometimes when I'm talking to people, I'm like, oh yeah, I work in the advisory section of the business, more to do with professional speakers and that. They're like, oh, you know, like the tech speakers, like the speakers you use to play music and those things. Like,
not quite,
but I can see where you're going with that one. That's great, Ash. And so in saying that, you know, this podcast is about your experience, is about what you've been up to, what you've been learning over the last 10 years. And in coming to celebrate that, we know your LinkedIn post, like I mentioned before, did resonate with a lot of people, and you had lots of tidbits there that I think we would all love to glean from a bit more and just hear a bit more context around. And so we're just going to actually dive right into those, if that's all right.
Let's do it.
I'm not sure, unfortunately, on this podcast, we'll have the time to go through all of them. But if we want a part two, I think we can make that known, get the reviews going. But we'll start with the first one, which I think is a really great idea here about living in the tension. That was your first in your post. And in your first 10 years, your post, you wrote, life is lived in the tension. And that's recognizing the dualities of situations and, living in that middle space. So could you elaborate for us a little bit on how embracing this both and perspective has shaped your approach to work and life over the last decade?
Yeah, I've made this note on the podcast. I should go back and maybe get some sort of AI technology to see how many times I've said the words. One of my favorite words is tension. I feel like it's something that I took a while to learn, because I think when you're quite young in your life and career and experience, you think, oh, what's good and what's bad? What's kind of, is this good or bad? Is this a positive or a negative? And especially I think in our kind of time poor, message saturated environments, it's really easy to be like, I just need to know whether I should do A or B or whatever the decision might be or the topic. And I feel like the older you get just in life and the more experiences you have with people and projects and even writing of books and trying to discern about technology for Gen Alpha, like all these experiences I've had, even in research, you kind of get to explore the pros and the cons. And a lot of the thought leaders that I've listened to, even like Brené Brown or Simon Sinek, people I have read the work of, I feel like what they do really well is they explore the tension of topics. They go, in this context, it can be a positive, but in this one, it can be a negative. And I just think it's helpful as we think about relationships and work and jobs and, you know, career prospects, but even projects or things you might be assigned where you're trying to evaluate something, especially when you're starting out, or even if you're in your 20s, where you're like, okay, I've got to look at all these areas. And even for me, I mentioned the example before, but probably what was really highlighted to me, and it's highlighted to me every time I do a presentation about Gen Alpha, is we talk about technology and just that it's, I feel like people are like, so Ash, tell us, screens, good or bad, do we embrace it or do we try and like, try and stop it or kind of really resist it? And I'm like, well, it depends on the context. It depends on the situation, because the context will determine whether it's good or bad, or there's probably both and, like, where technology can enable us to be more connected and engaged and it can teach us so much, but then at the same time it can be addictive and it can be this. And so I just think I just thought having that word, life is lived in the tension, even beyond your career, is a helpful thing to keep in mind, because not everything is yes or no, black or white. It's often the gray. And learning to appreciate the complexities in situations, I think, actually gives us wisdom.
That is so true. That's so, and I feel like that started us off really strong. I don't know how we're going to keep topping the advice.
It's all downhill from here.
It's all downhill. We know it won't be, but that is a very strong start. And it is so true. I think even just within, you know, interacting with colleagues and people in your world, I think if people took this approach where not everything has to be so black and white, there would be less tension with people, like not tension in the good way you're talking about here and the necessary tension, but in the way that things actually, there can be strengths there, but there also can be opportunities for change and challenges. And it doesn't need to be one or the other. That is great advice, especially, what you mentioned, starting out in your career, building those first early stages to kind of have that more balanced perspective, which you definitely learn as you get more experience in things as well. But that is fantastic, Ash. We're going to move right along to another piece of advice which you gave us, which is saying yes to opportunities that scare you is a really inspiring sort of idea, but is a lot scarier in practice. But could you please share a specific instance with us where taking such a leap led to significant personal or professional growth, or both?
Yeah, absolutely. So this one probably might come across a little bit obvious, you know, when you're young and you're starting out and everything is kind of scary because everything is new and you don't have the confidence or maybe the reputation to kind of back yourself. Like now I still have days where I feel like an imposter or I get a bit nervous, but I go, no, actually you've got to have that self-talk where you're like, nah, you've been doing this for 10 years. You've got these experiences. You just got to back yourself even when you don't feel it. But I guess when you have those opportunities in front of you where you're like, gosh, I have no experience. I have no way to kind of thing to lean on. That's really scary. And it just definitely relates to me to a piece of advice that I heard from Richard Branson, actually, in one of his books or publications. And it's funny because he was actually my previous employer, like technically, when I was working at Virgin Active, which is a set of gyms here or health clubs here in Australia. I worked there part-time while I was at uni. I did heaps of different roles in that organization, from like gym floor stuff to kind of operations within the club to even like head office. So I got to see a whole range of different assets of that organization. And his quote is, if you're presented with a great opportunity and you don't think you can do it, say yes and learn how to do it later. And I think it's that idea that I think, especially not to stereotype genders, but I know for me as a woman, oftentimes you're like, well, I can't do this thing until I actually tick every single box, until I like, maybe that's a perfectionist tendency where you're like, I want to be so prepared. I want to give it my all and I can't do something if I'm only like 30% of the way there. But you're actually never 100% ready for anything. And so it's about stepping out into things that do so scare you, and you do learn along the way. And I think it was John Maxwell who said, growth occurs when you're outside your comfort zone. And it's uncomfortable, of course, because you're like stressed and crying the night before the prezzo or whatever it might be. But like that's when you're actually learning and you're putting in the work, and then you reflect and you learn. So back to your question though, some of those really obvious opportunities that scared me when I kind of felt like I didn't have the qualities or the experience to say yes were when Mark asked me to do that first paid professional speaking engagement. When I had the opportunity to co-author the books with him, I was like, what do you mean? I can't be an author. I'm in my 20s. Like, there's no way I can't do this. And when I had to do, or not when I had to do, but when I had the opportunity to do the TEDx talk, that was a really career defining moment. And I've never prepped for anything so much because you can't have any notes, you can't have any preview slides, you have to memorize like 60 slides, and I made mistakes, but you know, only I know about those. So they've been those opportunities, and I'm so thankful that I did do it when I was scared, because they have led to other things and I was able to learn and grow from them and gain experience. But I think especially for young women, I'm like, don't take yourself out of the running, just say yes and do it even if you're scared.
No, absolutely. Oh, that is such good advice, Ash. And I feel like every single one of us can apply that in our own sphere, you know, not for everyone that's going to look like saying yes to your first professional speaking opportunity, you know, maybe for some, and that's amazing. But, you know, there's different areas where we're all involved in our work or in our life where there are things that scare us, you know, and there is definitely a lean toward wanting to be comfortable, wanting to feel secure, not wanting, the fear of failure is so real as well, you know, not wanting to try something out. But it's just really cool to think that 7 years ago, you had made that decision to really step out of your comfort zone with the speaking opportunity and do that, and just to see how you've grown and developed in that. And that I could imagine as well, yes, it gets easier in your experience, but I think every single time you do it, there's still an element of it that I could imagine. There's a bit of nerves, you know, you're going to speak in front of an audience. You never really graduate from that, I could imagine. I mean, I'm speaking on behalf of you. I don't know if that's true.
Oh, no,
You could say, no, I am.
Yeah, no, absolutely. And it's just one of those things where it's like, it's so public, like literally, yes. Like I could fall over. That's my worst fear, that I'll fall over and people will be like, Ashley fell. Like it's that's my name and their partner will be there. That's my worst fear.
That, why does it work so well though?
Like, I know.
I don't wish that upon you, but that's also funny, and I kind of want that to happen just for the joke of it all. But
the joke of it all. But I mean, yeah. All that is to say, like anything where your name's on something public is, of course. There's the risk goes up so high because you're like, gosh, anything could happen. I could say something accidentally, something awkward or embarrassing could happen, and it's not like you're behind a report or behind a screen. You're in front of people. So yeah, the fear is always there, but also it's good to have a bit of adrenaline fear, I think, as well. So.
No, exactly. And I think it's great because you highlighted, even with the tension, like your first point there with the tension, it's you have the tension of the confidence of your experience and stepping into it, but then also recognizing the weight and responsibility you have when you are speaking publicly. You know, you don't take that lightly. And I don't know who said it, but I heard it once, someone talking about how anyone that kind of is speaking in those public spaces, the moment you become too comfortable with that, you're not recognizing the responsibility of it. And I just think that is, I guess the perfect tension that you, all of our advisors really see, is that they recognize the weight of going and sharing the data and the insights in public spaces and helping that inform strategy and decision making, but also having the confidence that, you know, you've worked here 10 years, you know what you're talking about. You've been in the midst of this research across numerous reports. You've been doing it. And so I think that's really great. And I like what you highlighted there about learning as well. It's all an opportunity to learn, which leads into your next point, which you emphasize the significance of learning in your post, from reading being a secret power to learning through osmosis, which is a fun word there. But can you elaborate a little bit on what you mean by learning through osmosis, but how you've maintained a posture of learning throughout your career?
Yeah, it's definitely something that I see a lot of value in. And again, like the word tension, I feel like osmosis, it kind of just dawned on me once. I don't know. I mean, I did biology in high school, much to my biology teacher's dismay, because I wasn't very good at that subject. I was more like English and history. And then I was I'll do a science. The bio sounds a bit easy. And I was like, not cut out.
Not easy.
This. Yeah. Not easy. But I remember learning about osmosis, which is a biology term. It's about cells passing through like a barrier or something. And I think.
Something like that.
Something along those lines. Yeah. Someone who's done a biology teacher listening, please confirm. But it's kind of that idea in a workplace that you're learning without you being aware that you're learning. So I think so much of that happens when you're starting out in a new workplace, because you're in a new environment, you're around new people, especially when it's your first job or so, or your internship, whatever. Like, you're learning just by sitting next to someone and hearing how they answer the phone. You're learning by how they respond to an email, what language they use. It's almost like even culture in an organization is absorbed, like, without you being aware of it. You're not sitting there taking notes. Like, culture is number one. They write like this, or they say these things, or they behave this way. And so I think, especially in this kind of work from home, hybrid working environment, I think that's where we might lose that a little bit. And I hope that there'll be opportunities for younger people who are starting out in their careers to be in the workplace, to be in an actual environment where they actually can learn from people, because I think that osmosis just learns so much. And it's also that links to that piece of advice you might have heard, where it's like, you become like the people you spend the most time with. Like, and so surround yourself with people that are inspiring or that you admire, because you're inevitably going to become like them without you even consciously being aware of it.
Yes.
So that's kind of what I think it's about. But also just that posture of learning is something that I've always tried to maintain, and something I like to think I'll always try and maintain, because A, we work in a research organization where you're constantly learning about society and people and the environment, and there's always new trends. But also I think it links to being humble, and it links to, again, that idea of the tension, where it's like, I want to be confident. I want to be a girl boss, and I want to be, you know, sassy and confident, but I also want to be humble, and I want to be kind, and I never want to be too big for my boots or think of myself too highly or put myself on a pedestal too high. Yep. Do you know what I mean? So it's like that, I think it relates to that as well. So I think that posture of learning is really important. And I put in there just, I think reading has been something for me that, I mean, I love reading for pleasure. Like, I read a lot of fiction before I go to sleep at night. Like, it's a way to switch off, it's a way to learn. But I also think we've got so much access to, like, brilliant minds of our of our age through books, and it's like free resources where they just lay out their thoughts. And I mentioned a couple earlier, like Brené Brown or Simon Sinek or just Adam Grant's another one, like people who've got amazing ideas and concepts who get paid a lot of money to go and speak on big stages, but they also write books that you can buy and you can read. And I read a lot when I was doing writing the other books. I was almost like reading, and it probably came from that imposter syndrome vibe. I was just like, I must read everything anyone's ever written so that I don't like write something that someone else has like already said. And I was like, well, duh. So it was that idea where it's like, I just think we can learn so much from reading. And I'm also a firm believer that if you read more, you're probably going to be a better writer and a better communicator.
Absolutely.
So I'm a big advocate for reading, especially among younger generations.
Yeah, no, that's great. And correct me if I'm wrong, but you have input, I think, is one of your top
strengths.
It's your top number one strength, right? So it makes sense. So that input of you really see and put a lot of value and importance on, the impact that reading and gathering information and that has. And I think that's fantastic. And it's so true. And I just thinking back of what you're saying about osmosis, I feel like if we just see everything as an opportunity for osmosis, like in our work and in our life, you're constantly learning from the people around you. What are they saying? And even with books as well, I can find it hard personally to kind of find time to be sitting there, or opportunities where I'm sitting and reading. Maybe I'm driving somewhere doing something. So I don't know if everyone learns this way, but I would 100% recommend like audiobooks. Amazing. Or that sort of thing where you can just have it playing. And even if you're not listening to every single word, it's almost like that osmosis thing that you're just absorbing the information, even if you're not listening to every single word that's kind of coming through. You're just listening and paying attention. And so I think that's great, Ash. I can definitely see how that input strength has led you to where you are today. That's fantastic. But so moving on here, so you also wrote in your reflections that being underestimated, this is a good one, can sometimes turn out to be a hidden advantage. So can you share an experience where being underestimated fueled your determination and positively impacted your work?
Yes, I wrote this for all young people, but again, young women. I feel like, because for me, that imposter syndrome was really there and I felt it. And I have been, I guess, quite lucky. I haven't had a lot of circumstances where I've been spoken down to, or I mean, of course, there every now and then, you know, someone is a bit condescending because you might look young and they're like, oh, what do you know? And that's understandable. I want to respect people who've got more tenure and experience and respect our elders and who've got more wisdom. I appreciate that. But also, I think especially just how I look sometimes, like 5 years ago, I was this young mid-20s blonde girl getting up on a stage. Everyone's like already, especially if it's a conference where they have to be there, the audience is like, why am I here? Who are you? Why should I listen to you? Like, what do you have to say?
What do you have to say?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And I think also something that Mark said to me once was, when I was kind of talking and expressing my concerns about this kind of imposter syndrome, his words to me, which are words that I won't, I think, ever forget. He said, he's like, you can do it, Ash, you'll be great, you know. And then he was like, don't, just remember, like, you're speaking on the authority of the research, not just your own thoughts or, you know, your 20-something-year-old thoughts. And that kind of gave me the confidence to be like, oh, yeah, even though I might doubt myself or what I have to say, I'm actually not just here to talk about my experience. Like, I mean, this podcast, I'm literally talking about my experience.
and we're loving it.
But that previous speaking engagement, you know, I was like, oh, no, okay, yeah, I can talk about the research we've done because I've been in the organization now for X amount of years. And even the way that Mark kind of gave me some advice around how to have a strong introduction to connect to your audience, but also to establish your credibility and to give you that confidence when you're getting underway before you launch into the content, is something I've always kind of really applicable public speaking tips that I've taken with me, that I've taught other people, that I've given advice about. So definitely, I think just even younger generations, and I apply this, and we talked about this actually on one of the episodes with Sophie in a previous podcast, where it was about, you know, tips for Gen Z entering the world of work, which is kind of similar to what we're talking about today. Yeah. It's the idea that if people are underestimating you, I think turn it into a positive and let it fuel you and go, okay, you might think I'm a Gen Z who's lazy or entitled or not going to work hard, but I'm actually going to prove you wrong. And if the bar's low, it's easier to exceed. Like sometimes I think, oh, great. If they think this is going to be a boring demographics and data presentation, excellent, because hopefully they'll be even more wowed by the time I finish, where they might have
you
had
will
some
be
laughs.
Laughing.
You'll be laughing. Exactly. I think we sometimes say it's like infotainment. So it's like weird blend of like heaps of data and insights and robust stuff, combined with like fun stories and relatable things and jokes and memes and humor. And so that's the goal for me. And that's where I'm like, okay, it's sometimes it is disheartening to go, oh, that person's been a bit condescending, or they think I'm under equipped, or just because I'm young and I'm don't have the tenure or experience, they kind of underestimate me. But I'm like, well, in my experience, rather than viewing that as a barrier, I'm like, nah, it's going to fuel me to hopefully deliver something amazing, where they go, wow, that exceeded our expectations. And so that's the advice that I've
Great advice. Yeah, that's so good. And I think it really does go to show as well the power of words and how much, not only what other people say, but what you're saying to yourself, how you're letting that narrative and, the words that people have spoken to you, how you kind of allow that to define you or to fuel you in this case as well, to even when they're negative words, turning that around and using it as fuel to exceed those expectations. And it's great what you had highlighted even there, what Mark had spoken to you about giving you that advice, and how you mentioned, you know, I'll never forget that, and how much those kind words and those encouraging words really can lead someone in a particular direction, you know, and you took those on board and allowed that to impact you. And I think that actually leads well into our next point, unintentionally, but I just saw it. But it's actually the impact of kindness, which is great. So words of encouragement, I genuinely didn't plan that. It seems like this is a great transition. I swear this is just happening in the moment, but words of encouragement can have profound impacts. Can you recall a moment when you received or gave such words and witnessed their substantial impact in the workplace or in personal interactions as well?
Yes. So I had planned to use that example that I just gave in the previous answer for this, where I was like,
sorry.
No, that is, do not be sorry. But I think that was for me definitely one of the particular instances where Mark gave me some words that really just, where I was feeling out of my depth, where I was feeling kind of like, oh gosh, I don't know if I can do this. Like, are you sure you want me to go out on behalf of this organization and represent us in this way? Because like, I'm just little old Ashley Fell, or probably my maiden name at that time. You know, I was like, I can't do this. And he's like, no, you can. And I think for me, like, we actually put this in the Gen Alpha book, about equipping and raising Gen Alpha to be leaders themselves. And it was these three E's. We love a good alliterated kind of concept here at McCrindle. Yes. And the first E is encouragement. The second E is equip. And the third E is to entrust. And I think so often we almost just, and this was the point that I was saying here in this post, like we almost forget how impactful words can be. I'm sure even like I've, and this is demonstrated in so many examples where like you receive heaps of praise and heaps of like feedback or encouragement, and then you receive one negative thing and that just weighs on you, like how much that can drag you down. And so I think it is important to treat our words with the impact that they do carry and the weight they carry. Remember what you say has a profound impact on someone. But like you said, a word of encouragement can actually have like a career defining impact on someone. And also, but even beyond that, like Mark's feedback to me that in that circumstance was very specific about the task that was like immediately before me and how I felt about it. But the other thing I've learned about people and just in life, and this is one of my favorite quotes and I hope that I try and live by it, is be kind, for everyone you know is fighting a hard battle. And just the older I get, the more I realize that everyone has tough things going on in their life, or your colleagues have got families and stories and contexts, and you just don't know what someone's going through. And so, you know, you might even say something that you're just like, I'm just going to encourage this person or give them a compliment or whatever it might be. And it just hopefully it rolls off your back and you're like, oh, whatever, nice, kind deed for the day. But that could have like a profound impact on someone. And I put that in that reflection. I was like, your word could like have impacts beyond what you could even imagine, whether it's about their career or about their mental health or whatever it is. So I think kindness is important. I think remembering our words have impact, particularly if you're a leader in an organization and, you know, people are looking to you and they might hold you in high esteem, and it's like you could just take a moment to say something kind to someone and that could make their day or their week or lead them down a particular career path or give them the confidence to pursue things. So I think it's really, really important and something that I, hopefully never want to forget and want to always kind of use to the to the benefit of the people around me and in my life.
Well, I can say for one, Ash, you are most definitely an encourager. So you are living that out. And that's so good. It does make me think as well. I think it's a saying of like, it costs nothing to be nice. Like it costs nothing to be kind. It costs nothing to encourage. And I think it's just kind of finding those opportunities. Yeah, like you said, whether you're a leader or someone's friend or a stranger on the street, you know, just taking those little moments and not wasting them to be kind and encouraging. Like you said, you have no idea the impact that can have. So that is so good, Ash. Moving on, it's your insight about progress over perfection is powerful. You mentioned embracing imperfection in your post. Could you share a project or a moment in your career where embracing imperfection led to unexpected positive outcomes or growth?
Yes, absolutely. The books, full stop.
The books. That's it, moving on.
The books, yeah. I just think those books were so hard. They were really a lot of work. And, you know, every time I get like someone saying, oh, that book really helped, or it gave me a new perspective or hope for my kids' generation, whatever it is, I'm like, oh, thank goodness, because there was so much blood, sweat and tears that went into those projects, just so much. And I think that imposter syndrome was peaking with the books. I was like, gosh, like what do I have to say? And I have to keep coming back to those words from Mark, where it's like, it's not just your thoughts, it's actually research-based, and you've been in this business now for X amount of years and you've read a lot of reports and been involved in all these things, and you've got more knowledge and wisdom and experience than you might give yourself credit for. And so particularly with that regard though, like I'm sure anyone who's written a uni assignment or had to do something for school where you're like the blank page that's in front of you when you're just trying to start something.
Daunting.
It's daunting. And like that idea where it's like, okay, I've got to start with like the most profound thing I've ever heard about this particular topic or something I know. And it's like, actually just get all of it out, like just start. And that's where today, like ChatGPT is an amazing benefit, hopefully, to people, because it gets rid of that blank page. It's like it can just start something for you. And I think for me, like with the books even, it was like, I've just got to get the words out. I've got to get something on the page, and then I've got to leave it for a bit. I've got to come back, and then I'll start to refine it, and then I'll start to tweak it and move it. And all of a sudden you're moving things around, and in the 6 hours that you've been working on it, it's changed dramatically and drastically. And I think for me, what I learned then is like perfection also is a myth. Like nothing is ever perfect. Nothing you create or you do is ever going to be 100% in your mind where it should be. You're always going to, even the books, I'm like, oh, in hindsight, I could have changed that or written that paragraph differently, or something else has come to light. And so I think the fear of imperfection is something that really stops us from trying sometimes, or it
so
can.
True.
And so I think that was just something, especially with the books, that I've just learned, where it's like, it's about progress rather than kind of just doing something quickly and getting it right the first time. It's actually like just
so true.
Get something out, get something down, create something, and it will then just evolve and become to a point where you can release it into the world, and you learn heaps in that process. So that was definitely
so
something
true.
That I've tried to just, a lesson I keep having to learn as well. And a lot of these are lessons I keep having to learn.
Yeah. Constant lessons. No, but that's so good. And it's so true. And I mean, it is a hard pill to swallow for us perfectionists out there who do want, and there's nothing wrong with wanting to give your best and wanting to strive to do really great, but you're so right. It is such a myth. Perfection is such a myth, and there will always be nitpicking. There will always be things that you can look back in hindsight and say, oh, I would have done this differently. But like you mentioned, it's a continual growth track. It's a continual journey. You know, you press on, and that starting, you know, if you put all the pressure of perfection on yourself right from the get-go, you just won't begin. So you're so right. That blank page, just going for it and seeing where it takes you, is such great advice. But in writing the book, speaking of writing them, you mentioned blood, sweat and tears going into that. I could only imagine, and I've heard, I mean, you wrote them before I started here, but I have heard tales of your hard work that went into that. And so a big part of what I'm sure you've had to learn amongst that advisory thing, all of what you do, is prioritizing rest, which is the next piece of advice that you gave from your post, and you highlighted the importance of regular rest for a sustainable career. How have you managed to incorporate these restful rhythms into your professional life, and what impact has these had?
Yeah, I put two things in this particular point. I said big holidays are amazing and awesome and like really good for your mental health and motivation, because you've got something to work towards, and like it's like a reward for, it's like a reward.
That TikTok trend. Don't say it.
I took us there.
Yeah, great.
So yeah, I mean, those big holidays are important. I've had some really awesome, like rewarding, cool holidays, work-related trips, non-work related trips, like with my family and my friends and my husband, and like loved it. And that's an important part of rest. But I think, again, just reflecting on like the 10 years like that I've been here, I'm like, gosh, I actually have seen people who have been similar roles to me in similar organizations burn out and have chronic fatigue, and I don't know all of the ins and outs of what was going on in their life, so I'm not here to make a judgment call on that or how they could have avoided it. But I think for me, it's been about having like regular rest, and it's kind of almost like micro rest, like whether it's daily habits or weekly habits, rather than just like pushing hard for months or weeks until that big holiday where you just like, and I think we've all done that, or if you have done that, you'll know that you almost take like half the holiday to just unwind before you actually get to rest.
So true.
And you can even, that still happens when you take regular rest and daily rest. But I think having whatever practices look like, whether it's meditation or prayer or mindfulness or just listening to an audiobook to switch off or reading fiction before bed, like for me, that has been something that's like, that's time for me. That's something I get to enjoy when I've got a big day traveling, or a big week traveling interstate for work, whatever it might be. It's like just finding those moments where it's like, okay, I'm just refilling my tank rather than just going till you get empty. And I think it's just one of those things that it's going to look different for everyone. It's going to look different for your own like context, what your family is like, what your home life is like, how long you have to commute to the office or the workplace, like what type of work you're doing. Like it's all so very different. Like we're in a real like thinking job at McCrindle. It's very like there's a lot of thinking and writing that goes on. And so even like what kind of different type of rest, whether it's like creative rest or going for a run or whatever it might be. So I think regular rest is really important. And just the longer I've been in the workplace, the more important I've seen that to be for my relationships and my family, but also my ability to do great work. And one of those things, one of those amazing books that I read, which I think I've referenced on the podcast before, is called Why We Sleep. And I actually read it during the writing of the Work Wellbeing book. And it was just a really interesting insight, even like how important good quality sleep is for not just like your physical health, but it also has impacts on your emotional health and your ability to engage with your family and be there and show up for your friends and be creative. And so even just having good sleep patterns, like it's just such a thing that sometimes like that's the first thing that often goes when you're busy. You're like, oh, just the saying like I'll sleep when I'm dead or whatever it might be. But it's actually like, no, it actually has really big impacts. And I'm not saying I do that perfectly, but it's something I've just little habits I've tried to build into my life that I feel like have helped me kind of keep running this at this pace, you know, for 10 years.
It's fantastic and such important advice. And I think even from my experience and from people I've seen around me, I feel like burnout, only you recognize you're burnt out, or you only recognize burnout's happening once you're already burnt out. You know, you kind of get to that point and you're like, oh, it's almost too late by that time. And then you have to really reset and get back into those rhythms. So you're so right that integrating not just, you know, these long-term sort of vacations and rest periods and that sort of stuff, although that's all important, but what are the daily moments? You know, 10 minutes in the morning, don't check your phone, don't let that simulation of the world and the news and who needs you and all these sort of things get to you yet. You know, having that mindfulness time is so, so good, Ash. And we are sadly on our last question here for you today, and it's on relationships and laughter. So you had emphasized the significance of great colleagues and the importance of laughter in the workplace and in your job and what you do. And how have these professional relationships impacted your work and personal well-being, speaking of well-being, during your time at McCrindle? And why do you think that laughter is so important as part of that?
Yes, we kind of combined two of those trends here. I think I put in there in my reflections, you know, great colleagues are invaluable. And I have been so blessed and privileged to work alongside some amazing people in my 10 years here. You, of course, being one of them, Hol, it's been genuinely like so fun to develop a friendship with you. And of course, that professional collegiate relationship, but also friends outside of work, and same with other people who are at McCrindle at the moment, but also those who've kind of left for various reasons. And I just think, like, I read something once where it's like, it's not about the dream job, it's about the dream team. And it's interesting because, again, the tension, there's both sides to that. I agree and I disagree in some ways. It's like, I don't think the people can just mask if you really don't like the tasks you're doing every day. I don't know if that would be a big enough reason to, you know, stay with an organization or stay in a role. But I do think like the people you do work with have bear such a big impact on your enjoyment at work and your engagement, even having, of course, like competent people alongside you, but people that you get along with or that you can have fun with. Because we spend, like this was like the premise of the Work Wellbeing book. It's like we spend a third of our day or a third of our lives even like at work or working. And so I just think it is an amazing opportunity. I think the workplace for many people, I think it's 70% of Australians, it's the place they encounter meaningful social interaction and purpose. And so again, like let's not underestimate the value of having great people, because for some people, their work colleagues might be their only friendship group or social interaction. Yeah. And so, again, the tension of that is the workplace can't be everything for someone. There's got to be boundaries. It's not a family. It's there's contracts involved and, you know, people leave and that sort of thing. But I do think just for me, like working alongside people has been a real joy and given a lot of my work those days where you're like, oh, man, like it's been a tough week or it's been a lot. But you're like, oh, no, but I know I'm going to have a good time when because I'm going to see those colleagues and we're going to have fun at lunch or whatever it might be. We're going to go out for drinks after work, whatever it might be. And for me personally, I do think laughter is a bit of a secret source. I've talked to you about this before, even with presentations like professional speaking. I feel like my secret ingredient, the thing that I find has the biggest impact is not like the hard-hitting stats or figures. It's the ability for people to connect to what you're saying. And I think laughter has been the way that I've seen that be most impactful. I've evaluated different presentations where one's been a lot more serious and I've taken out the jokes that I normally have and I never get the same reception as the one where people, I've included the jokes and the humour about AI and Siri or the fax machine or whatever it might be, or poking fun at Gen Z or whatever it is. And people are like, oh, that was great. And they always talk about the things they remember are the jokes and the humour and the stories because they connect us. And so I think, yeah, laughter is important. I have read some studies as well just on how important it is to kind of have those moments of like release or I think in writing and literature it's called comic relief, where like even in a really serious movie, like they'll have a joke and it's like, oh, I just need to like take just a breath from like the thriller or whatever it is, like or the suspense or the tragedy. And it's like laughter is, I think, important because it does connect us. Of course, we're not just here to like laugh and have a good time. We're here to work and get things done. But I do hope and I try and be one of those people that like shifts the environment and helps people to enjoy their work but also have a good time while they do that. So I think laughter is important. And I wrote that in the post to pursue in your workplace and in your relationships and in presentations. Presentations. And it's hard to do as well. I will admit that. Like it's not easy to curate your type of humor or what's going to work with you or what feels natural, especially from a stage or from a platform. But I do think it is worth pursuing and exploring.
Absolutely. And that's some great advice to end on there, because that even just ties in so well with what you're saying with work well-being and, you know, resting and thriving in your workplace, which so much of this advice speaks to that. But yeah, just not taking the right thing seriously. And, you know, being serious in your work and being serious with what you've been entrusted with and the tasks that you have, but recognizing you can have fun along the way. It's the tension, not one or the other.
It's the tension.
It can be both. You can have fun and do amazing work at the same time and be diligent, but have a laugh with a colleague. You know, it goes hand in hand. So, Ash, this has been phenomenal. Thank you so much for all of your advice. I know I was so benefited listening to you expand on a lot of those points. I loved the LinkedIn post when you had done it and really took a lot from it, but it was great to hear a bit more of your insights, and I'm sure the listeners have felt the same. So thank you for the chat today.
Oh, thank you, Hol. Thanks for coming on and again allowing me to be a bit self-indulgent and just talk about my learnings and my career. I was like, oh, as we get to the end of the year, it might be a bit more of a chill episode. But no you're an amazing colleague and amazing behind the scenes, very involved person on this podcast. So I love that you get to be in front of the, when you get to be in front of the camera, and for our listeners to hear your beautiful North American accent.
Thank you.
And your wisdom. So thank you, Hol.
Oh, thank you, Ash. That is very, very kind of you. It's a privilege to be a part of the podcast. So speaking of the podcast, if you would like to stay up to date with McCrindle's latest insights, you can subscribe to this podcast, you can follow us on social media, or you can head to McCrindle.com. So as always, thank you again for listening, and bye for now.